Thank you. Members, we are approaching Christmas, and it seems that we are in the holiday mood, and the weather is cold. So I thank everybody for attending this meeting on time. We have a quorum, and this is the appointed time. This is the Bills Committee on Anti-Money Laundering and Counter-Terrorism Financing, Financial Institutions Amendment Bill 2017, and also Companies Amendment Bill 2017. This is the sixth meeting. Thank you. Thank you for attending on time. I should now invite the administration in. Good morning. This is the sixth meeting, so I won't go through the attendance list. We have a large team from the administration. Item 1 on the agenda, matters arising from the previous meeting. Before the meeting, the administration has submitted a response paper to issues raised at the meeting of the 11th of December 2017, and that's CB bracket 1, 375/1718/02. Would the administration like to walk us through the paper first? And then members can ask questions. Thank you, Chairman. Good morning. Yesterday we issued a response paper in relation to a number of issues raised by members at the last meeting. That's the fifth meeting. I'd like to highlight some salient points. At the last meeting, a member asked whether designated non-accounting professionals can be appointed as a third party for conducting customer due diligence and record-keeping requirements. We find these suggestions feasible after careful consideration. In due course, we'll follow up on the matter, and perhaps we can move a committee stage amendment to deal with that. At the last meeting, we were requested to explain what is meant by a TCPS doing that in the course of business. And it, as explained in the paper, if it is done on the friendly basis, not involving, you know, the way of business, it may not constitute the definition. But it depends on the case-by-case basis and the and also the facts of the case. We already set out our explanation in the paper. We hope to provide an answer to the member's question. Another question is on the record-keeping requirement. The law requires 6 years of record, and the FedEx's requirement is 5 years. We also gave this a careful consideration. We set the period of 6 years after careful consideration because many financial institutions also adopted the same six-year record-keeping requirement. And on the last occasion, in relation to the amendment to the AMLO, most FIs agreed with the arrangement, and we believe that it would be sound to keep the six-year record-keeping requirement. Perhaps I'll pause here and see if members have questions. Any follow-up question? Mr. James, no. Oh, Chairman, I find it really difficult. What? Really difficult. I mean, if you maintain the record-keeping requirement to 6 years, that means, policy-wise, you have always suggested that we should meet the minimum requirement, and now you're setting a precedent. Of course, legally speaking, you can do so, but if that is the way forward, it will be trouble for Hong Kong. If you insist that it be 6 years, I might, in principle, need to object to this bill because it's not the minimum requirement. It means you're not just meeting the minimum requirements of the international convention. I find it really difficult. Well, of course, you may not care because you have enough votes anyway. But I feel that I'm going to try my best to block the passage of the bill. Because if that is how you handle it, well, in the future, there may be a lot of other bills. And you must bear in mind that if you change it from 6 years to 5 years, even so, you'll be meeting the international requirements and you'll get the support of all members. I don't know whether you have conducted sufficient consultation. Is it the case that after consultation, the industry opposed changing the rule from 6 to 5 years? Judging from common sense, I find it unbelievable. But I can only say that I am deeply resentful and I am upset about this change. I don't usually block such bills, but you're playing such a trick. I'd like to make it known to the administration, and it's for them to decide. I understand Mr. James Toh's attitude. And for the administration, it's not just about this four-hour meeting today. We do have another meeting in the future. So perhaps the administration could also consider Mr. James Toh's suggestion. Well, for the stamp duty ordinance, the experience is this. You did some consultation. I don't know whether it had to do with, you know, say, labor issues with the Labor Advisory Board, which has quite a major stake. Well, perhaps you did consultation, and then that's what they said, you need to put it down. Now, I'm asking, after consultation, if it's changed from 6 to 5 years, would it cause injustice to some? Say, for the stamp duty ordinance, let's say if the period for replacing the property is 6 years, and then some members may be moving amendments. I, for one, would be moving an amendment. And then if that's the outcome of the consultation, then so be it. We can change it from 6 to 5 years, and then I'll try to lobby support of members. I don't know whether you are playing this trick, because Mr. Frank Chan, the Secretary for Transport and Housing, is certainly playing that trick. I don't know. I will recommend that all Democrats proactively oppose this bill. That's Mr. Toh's view. If the administration insists that it should be one of 6 years, then Mr. James Toh, of course, is entitled to move amendments himself. So would the administration also consider his suggestion? So that's it. That's on the last issue. For the first issue, about the applying the statutory CDD and record-keeping requirements to the legal professionals. Well, I want to know what this is about. A CSA, did you say? Last time we touched on two issues. First, whether a third party could be engaged as an intermediary. We carefully considered the suggestion. We're going to do it. We find it feasible. All right, so they've taken on board our view. Then please give us a CSA draft CSA as soon as possible. Well, they may not be able to give us the draft CSA this meeting. Then let's do it as soon as possible. The Secretariat will hurry them. Any other questions? If not, we can continue with the class-by-class scrutiny. We were on page 2, and then page 3 and 4 blank pages, so we can resume at page 5. Page 2? Let's go back to page 2. Mr. Toh has a question. Yes, Mr. Toh. We have the additional 1 capital A here. Now, one originally relates to an authority. I suppose it represents the government. For one, capital A, the regulatory body refers to, say, the law society and the accountancy association, etc. I don't know whether you have similar laws in this regard, whether a body would be entrusted or commissioned to draw up, you know, something like a code of practice for regulatory purpose, and then there will be immunity for the regulatory body. Because I see the wording in 1 and 1A is similar, but I'm thinking, well, let's say if you grant immunity to the authority in 1, meaning the government, it usually enjoys the highest level of immunity because, for prudence sake, the government is exercising public power. For one, capital A, again, is about the exercise of public power. But I see the immunity offered to the regulatory body is the same. I don't know whether you have two levels of immunity in the law. Can you give me one example, or would they be the same? Thank you, Mr. Toh, for your question. And for Section 4, Subsection 1, the relevant authority refers to the Hong Kong MA, SFC, the Insurance Authority, and the C&E Department, not the government as a whole. For Hong Kong MA, SFC, Insurance Authority, they are responsible for the regulation of their own industries under this ordinance. So that's the immunity offered under Section 4, Subsection 1. Well, but I believe that in the future, the Law Society, the Hong Kong ICPA, and also the Insurance Authority will also need to fulfill the same duties, so they should be offered the same level of immunity. And for one, capital A, the key is that the act is done in good faith. So if it's not done in good faith, then no immunity will be granted. But I can give you one example. Also on AML and CTF, not led by the administration, though. It was many years ago. Well, let's say if there was a mistake in announcing that a certain party or a certain person is a terrorist, it would be a major mistake. And then the business representatives back then objected to the administration's proposal. It's not as lax as in good faith that one could enjoy immunity. For example, let's say if a serious, how do you call it, serious negligence or serious dereliction of duty. How do they fare? I want to know the rationale of adopting in good faith, because it offers the highest level of immunity. Would it be unfair? Thank you, Mr. Toh. Last time, thanks to Mr. Toh for reminding us, we went back to check the relevant anti-terrorism law of the United Nations, and there is also an immunity clause. And indeed, it may involve some serious issues. Say, when a public officer announces that a certain person is a terrorist, then the outcome would be, or the consequence would be, the proceeds or the assets being frozen. So if there is a mistake on the part of the public office, the consequence could be dire. And that is why there is a tighter level of immunity. Whereas in this exercise, the regulatory body does not have a lot of powers and obligations. It's about enforcing disciplinary actions, and they are already enforced under the relevant professional regulations. So About this section 4, the function of the regulatory body may be to draw up guidelines, and this is something different from the scenario you cited. As for the immunity granted in other pieces of legislation, if we take a look at the Hong Kong ICPA's ordinance and also the insurance or the estate real estate agents ordinance, they also have similar provisions. But the only safeguard we have is that as long as the guidelines are done in good faith, then it will do. But for somebody making the mistake, as I cited in the previous scenario, it will not be given this immunity, right? In an extreme scenario, for example, if a regulatory body promulgates some arbitrary guidelines, then it will be breaching this clause. And let's say in that scenario, if a public officer makes a mistake like that, will it be offered immunity under Section 41A? My understanding of the of Mr. James So's question is whether the immunity is provided to the party promulgating guidelines, or rather the other side. Well, it's a regulatory body, as mentioned by Mr. James To. Now, in relation to the CCD under the ordinance, the scope has been defined, and in Schedule 2, it provides solid legal basis, and that legal professionals should be subject to the regulatory requirements. And I was referring to some guidelines, because in Section 7, you will see that the regulatory bodies is empowered to draw up guidelines for the operation of Schedule 2, and that is to say whether the guidelines are drawn up in good faith.
Our legal advisor would provide some information for reference. For the Professional Accountants Ordinance and Estate Agents Ordinance in the PAO, the exemptions are provided in Section 32G, subsection 2, and the provisions are similar as Section 4, brackets 1. As for Estate Agents Ordinance Cap 511, in Section 54, the provisions are also similar.
Good faith
咁樣嘅，即係都係咁樣。咁就誒，咁同埋我，所以 I have a question for the legal advisor. As I know, the subsection 1A is something under the ordinance. So does it refer to acts according to the code rather than something falling under discipline? In terms of the exercising of discipline, well, this provision is based on the ordinance. Anything done under the ordinance, if they are only empowered to issue practice direction P, the remaining would be handled under Cap 50. See your Cap 511. So that I just want to clarify this because that might lead to objections. All right, let's go on page 5. And clause 6 is refers to clause 6, and this is a simple technical amendment. And 12 brackets 4 refers to the UN anti-terrorism measures. The ordinance is being amended, so we have to make a technical amendment to align the numbering. Section 7 of the bill, after Section 5, there would be a new Section 5A. And Schedule 2 has effects in relation to DNFBPs. And this would apply to DNF BPs, and this would only apply in specific transactions. For example, the purchase and sale of properties, etc. Please hold. Our legal advisor has something to say. In the new Section 5A, the wording copies the wording from Article 22 of the Financial Action Task Force for the DNFBPs. When these individuals engage in specific transactions, they have to comply with the Schedule 2 requirements. And the English version says, prepares for or carries out for a client a transaction. So it copies the wording of the FedEF. And what is actually meant by prepares for? Can the government cite some examples in illustrating what is meant by prepares for? For example, if a client approaches a law firm in Hong Kong and the client requests that a company be set up in the UK, if the UK office refers the client to their London office in order to facilitate relevant transactions, so would the Hong Kong office be considered as carrying out preparation? Thank you very much. And prepares for does not depend on the location of the client. So the key is that the business is conducted in Hong Kong. For a Hong Kong law firm, for example, if a foreign client wants to buy a property in Hong Kong, they would commission a Hong Kong law firm, and the Hong Kong law firm would charge a professional fee, and that would constitute preparation. What about the example I cited? Would the answer be negative? The location of the client is not a deciding factor. As I said, the way of business is most important, so it depends on the actual case or example. If a firm prepares transaction documents, or if they help inspection records at the lands registry, etc. These tasks are conducted in Hong Kong, and fees would be charged. Ms. Chang, on what Mr. Low just said, if the business is conducted in UK, the UK office would be seen as conducting the preparation, and such transaction would be governed by the UK laws. Is this the correct understanding? If a client conducts a purchase or sale in the UK, and if they purchase a Hong Kong property via a UK firm, that should not be in question. If a Hong Kong client commissions a Hong Kong law firm to conduct some business in the UK, so the UK office would be considered as conducting the preparation. Is that correct? If the preparation is conducted by a UK law firm, then it would be immaterial. If a Hong Kong solicitor helps a Hong Kong client and charges a professional fee, I think that the spirit is about who the client actually is. If I'm a Hong Kong solicitor and I help a Hong Kong client carry out preparation, and if a professional cost is or fee is incurred, then that client would be seen as a Hong Kong client of mine. So if a relevant firm charges a fee in Hong Kong, they will be seen as carrying out preparation. I think what the legal advisor said show that even if a Hong Kong accounting firm or law firm conducts a very small task, they have to do a lot of things in order to justify that task. For example, if a UK conglomerate is to set up a company in Hong Kong to facilitate future work, so there is creation of a company in Hong Kong under Section 5A brackets 3 brackets E. So they are to set up a company, and there is a mother company. And let's suppose that this subsidiary is wholly owned by the parent company. I might only charge a few $1,000s for secretariat services. It might be $2,000 or $3,000 only. And you might sign some notes with them and specify who the subscribers are, and you need to examine the entire parent company. So I don't think that is very pragmatic. For trust companies, they might want to set up a subsidiary in Hong Kong. So for a single step or task, I don't know how much we would charge. You know, even a few hundred thousands might not be enough. And we are going to move CSAs, and you said, Mr. Sun said, you would allow reasonable authorization. So for the same law firm, we need to split the costs internally, and we might be billed $100,000. And if I only charge like $250,000, how can I compete? This is a big problem. Is this what it is? You might say we can ask the HKICPA or Law Society, but they can never provide an answer because these are the requirements. If they ask their members to follow suit, as regulatory body, this is a problem with you. Before we had this ordinance, how did solicitors and accountants work? Let's suppose there's a UK firm which holds a Hong Kong company, and they would just give us their name. There's no need to investigate the parent company. So currently, no investigation is needed. Yes, according to what I understand. The registrar of companies, we would look at the actual company. I'm a council member of Hong Kong ICPA, so I'm quite familiar with the situation of accountants. Accountants would carry out due diligence. They need to declare suspicious cases. As for legal practitioners, they would also do the same, as I know. What do you mean by that? If I set up a new company, and for shell companies set up within the same day, those will no longer be possible. I think the ordinance is to prevent exactly that. Setting up a shell company and doing something through this company are different. So if they bring in cash out of nowhere, it would be very suspicious. But now they have not done anything yet, and you are imposing these on them, and this would really harm the competitiveness. And I think this is something FedEx is trying to prevent. As the legal advisor just said, we comply with the exact wording and requirements of FedEx, and the same set of standards also applies to other jurisdictions such as UK and Singapore. I think what Mr. Toh said is no cause for concern. As the registrar said, accountants and lawyers also need to carry out customer due diligence. And under AMLO, when we look at the Schedule 2 requirements, we stress that the measures must be reasonable. And we have stressed that we do not want to replace the function or the investigative function of our enforcement agencies. But when you deal with a client, you should know who your client is, and you must record the basic information, and that would be adequate. We are not asking the professionals to trace the source of funds or the company structure and so on. Mr. Low, I have something to add on what the administration said. And in Hong Kong, in Chinese, it says Yibei, and in English, the rendition is prepares for. So in the example in UK I cited for, the English rendition prepares for might be wider in meaning than the Chinese version. For example, a meeting might be arranged in Hong Kong, and the government said, it depends on whether a firm charges a fee in Hong Kong. Is this the correct interpretation? I think we have to look at the specific case. The spirit is that the business should be undergo preparation in Hong Kong, and there must be and the transaction must be carried out. So we would consider all these factors. The charging of a professional fee indicates that business is conducted by a professional. Mr. Toh, I think this is very dangerous. Like what the legal advisor said, if a law firm's if a UK firm asks an estate agent to prepare a temporary contract of purchase, and if they call up a law firm and ask about this contract, and the law firm is paid, and the agreement, the sales and purchase agreement has been signed. So is the law firm actually offering advice on this agreement, or are they or is the law firm just preparing to have the agreement signed? So so do I have to ask for all the information before I can conduct the business? They might be asking for the for legal advice and whether the estate agent is proper, but the purchaser is a UK firm. I do not know them, so they might be someone or a director in Asia Pacific, and now I have to carry out CDD on the UK firm before I can answer these questions. Is that what I have to do? This is not the case. The spirit of the law is that we're reasonably practicable, you must find out about your client. In this example, what you meant was that part of the transaction was completed in the UK. I was talking about a UK firm buying a property in Hong Kong. When a company engages in a business with a client, they have to know the basic information, like the name of the client. I'm sure every firm is doing that. Where reasonably practicable, firms should find out about their clients. And ideally, they should find out about their clients before the close of transaction. But in cases when the business relationship or transactions have started, the firms can still start to know about their clients, and this is allowed by the law. If you have a foreign client, for example, Mr. Smith, you should note down the basic information. That would be enough. Under the existing laws, such as the Organized Crimes Ordinance, in case of suspicion, the transaction must be declared. For such cases, can we handle them using professional guidelines? It's somewhat difficult to stipulate the cases in such detail in the laws. This is just not practicable. Can we deal with these cases with professional code of practice or guidelines? This is a very good idea, and this is exactly our spirit. The laws can never be exhaustive. So the laws would carry certain power. So in Section 7, the laws can provide allow for professional guidelines under AMLO, and based on the needs of professions, appropriate codes of practice can be provided.
Well, when it comes to carrying out a transaction, shouldn't it be the case that when you carry out a transaction that you have to be so detailed? Because a lot of the times, you're only asked a couple of questions. If you are to complete the transaction, of course, you're supposed to ask more questions. But there is no proportionality here. Well, if it is written in this way, I'm sure the Hong Kong ICPA will be quite shaken or shocked. I agree that it is not very clear with the word prepares for, but we have no choice because that is the wording used by the FATF. It's the recommendation 22 of the FATF. We have to follow that. Perhaps the administration may study into how to clearly set out the definition of this term. Or perhaps it can be done in a guideline. Maybe they can give us examples that these are not prepared for a transaction. Have you spoken to the associations? Have you? Yes, we have. Then that's fine. No, I mean it by the point of prepares for. Do you understand their concern? Before we introduce the blue bill, we have asked the relevant bodies to look at the draft. Maybe I will ask the legal advisor. Say there is a convention that uses the word prepares for. But I do think that the word carry out includes that meaning, but you think that it doesn't fulfill the requirements of the convention? I have read the recommendation 22 of FATF, But there is no definition or explanation of that word. Perhaps the administration has to talk to the FATF to see what the difference is between carry out and prepare for. The Chinese term is to prepare for. Perhaps the English term carries a wider meaning. Perhaps the administration will have to clarify with the FATF. Well, it's prepares for and or carries out, and then A to G. Are they all set out in the convention? That is A to G. I'm sorry, I have to go to the next meeting. Maybe we will suspend the meeting for 3 minutes.